Good evening. I'm Subhash Gatade. I belong to New Socialist Initiative. And I welcome you all for the Democracy Dialogue lecture series. It's the fourth lecture in the series. We are really thankful to Professor Aditya Mukherjee that he has accepted our invite to deliver a lecture, Jawaharlal Nehru and the Current Challenge to the Idea of India. We know the whole idea of India, which was propagated by Nehru, is itself under attack these days. And Nehru, his contributions to the building of India and all is being discredited. And we just wanted that Professor Aditya Mukherjee would be the right person to show light on it. As everybody knows that Professor Aditya Mukherjee has been associated with Center for Historical Studies, JNU, for the last more than four decades. Apart from that, he has been is a series editor of a state series in modern Indian history. And he's a member of Scientific Committee, International Review of Sociology, and regional editor, International Journal of Asian Studies, Tokyo. He has been visiting professor of at various international universities. He worked at Duke University. He was a visiting fellow at Institute of Advanced Studies, Lancaster University, and fellow at Institute of Advanced Studies, France, and as well at University of Rome. He is author and co-author of many books. Some of them I would name India's Struggle for Independence, which has gone into 80 reprints. India After Independence, Imperialism, Nationalism, and the Making of the Indian Capitalist Class. India Since Independence, Penguin, which has gone into more than 35 reprints. RSS, School Text, and The Murder of Mahatma Gandhi, The Hindu Commonwealth Project. So these are the few of the books, main books which he has written. Another interesting fact is that his books have been translated into many Indian languages. I was just reading, browsing the internet, Marathi, Tamil, and many other languages they have been translated. Before I invite Professor Adit Mukherjee for this, to deliver this lecture, there are two suggestions. Will we have a chat session? Professor Mukherjee will you have question answer session after this this thing? And so you please enter your chat box, enter questions in the chat box. Secondly, if you want to know the if you want to get a list of these to get details of future lectures, so please enter your contact details in the chat box. So I request Professor Aditya Mukherjee to start his lecture. I once again thank him for agreeing to our suggestion. Please.
I'd like to thank the New Socialist Initiative, particularly Mr. Subhash Kantajalji, for this opportunity to share with you my views on Jawaharlal Nehru and the challenges to the idea of India. As Subhashji just now said, these are days of demonizing Nehru. Lies are spread about him, a task which is done by the neoliberal, neocolonial right wing, which then feeds into a much more vicious attack that is launched by the Hindu communalists. Unfortunately, even the left too has had its share of Nehru bashing. But fortunately, that is long a thing which is long past. I mean, it is a matter of the past. The left fortunately doesn't do so anymore. But there was a time when it did so in very strong language. The communalists sometimes try to even erase the memory of Jawaharlal Nehru. As you are aware, in Rajasthan, when the BJP was in power, they actually brought out a textbook in which the whole chapter on the Indian National Movement did not even have a mention of Jawaharlal Nehru. He did not exist. you are also aware that the RSS mouthpiece in Kerala, Kesari, published an article by a BJP candidate for the Member of Parliament, Lok Sabha, where it was argued that Godse had fired the shot at the wrong person. It should have been Nehru, who was even more dangerous than Gandhi. But despite all these efforts to erase or caricature Jawaharlal Nehru, Nehru lives on and shall live on so long as the idea of India that he so quintessentially represented, so long as that idea lives on and there are people still there who are willing to fight for that idea. In fact, as it now said, that it is the opponents of the idea of India who will not let Nehru die. They are the ones who cannot forget Nehru. Just witness the center stage that Nehru occupies in the vicious propaganda that the right wing has launched in recent years. They will not let his memory die. Now, what is this idea of India? A phrase which was coined by Rabindranath Tagore that Nehru so brilliantly represented. Not only represented, but tried to implement in the newborn state for the initial decade and a half. The idea of India is actually the vision of, or the imagination of, our entire national movement. It's the vision that was put forward by the entire spectrum, I want to underline that, of the various strands of nationalists who participated in the national movement. From the moderates to the extremists, to the Gandhians, to the socialists, to the communists, to the revolutionaries, they all shared what I'm now going to list out for you, what constituted the essential ideas of India. They had their differences, but there was a consensus on these points. The only people who were not part of this idea of India were the loyalists, some of the princes, and of course, the communalists. They stood outside this idea of India. Now, what are the basic four elements of this idea of India? The first and the most important was sovereignty and anti-imperialism. The future India will be an independent country. It will not be a junior partner to any one of the superpowers, nor would it subjugate other people, other countries which are weaker than India. And India will continue to fight for the anti-imperialist cause anywhere in the world. So that was number one. Number two was equally important, was democracy. From its inception, the early nationalists who imagined this idea of India, from its inception, they were very clear that the future India would be a democratic India. As early as the 1890s, Tilak is talking of in the future constitution of India, it being adult franchise. This is decades before adult franchise has come in any part of the world. In women are still to get a vote many, many decades later. And even in countries like the United States, the civil rights movement went on till the 1960s. So it was, for the national movement, a very basic, original, maulik idea. The third idea, which emanates from the second idea, is that of secularism. In fact, in the days of the national movement, these two words were used coterminously. Secular democracy was the phrase that was used, because there is no democracy possible unless you have secularism. You cannot have democracy only for some people. And vice versa, there is no secularism possible unless you are truly democratic. That is, unless each citizen, irrespective of his gender, caste, religion, whatever, did not have an equal citizenship right. So this was the second one, third one. And the fourth, quite often noticed element in this idea of India, which, as I said, was accepted by all, was a pro-poor orientation. I'm choosing my words carefully. It is not socialist. Though increasingly a large number of the people in the national liberation struggle moved to the socialist idea, often because of Nehru, but yet this was not the consensus. But there was a consensus on a pro-poor orientation. From Dadabhai Naruji onwards, his first book is Poverty and Anti-British Rule in India. Poverty and British Rule in India. From Naroji to R.C. Das to Rana Day to Surendranath Banerjee, if you look at any of their writings, you will see that they put poverty in the focus of their understanding of why we need to fight colonialism. So from Naroji to Gandhi, who of course turns the face of the Indian people towards the poor, towards the Daridra Narayan, to Jawaharlal Nehru, to the socialists and the communists. This, there was a consensus on the pro-poor orientation. Now, all these elements are today under threat. I want to, before I come to that, I want to say that this imagination of the Indian nation was a unique and a very brave phenomenon. This is not how nation states emerged in the rest of the world. The Indian imagination was, in fact, in sharp contrast to the European imagination with which nation states first emerged in Europe. In Europe, as you are all aware, nation states emerged as homogeneous units. Catholic France, not even Christian, Protestant England, Germany is unified, the unification of Germany and Italy is on the basis of one language. France was a multilingual country till the French Revolution flattened it out into a one language country. In sharp contrast to this, the Indian imagination of the nation was to celebrate diversity. It was a diverse language or religion, etc., was going to enrich the Indian nation. They were complementary to the development of the Indian nation, not contradictory to it. The most famous Urdu poet, the most famous Assamese writer, the most famous Telugu thinker like Virasalingam, the most famous Tamil poet, were also the most famous nationalists. They were complementary to each other. Secondly, the European nation states emerged out of the rise of capitalism. And as you are all aware, in the very rise of capitalism was embedded imperialism or colonialism. That is, each nation state as it emerged in Europe, it also became an imperialist power. From Portugal, Spain, Germany, France, Italy, England, USA, just name it. They also became colonial powers. The Indian nationalist imagination on the other hand was opposite. It was a liberating phenomenon. This nationalism was a liberating, it was anti-imperialist. So it was not aggrandizing, it didn't have the dominating element that European nationalism had. The European vision of nationalism, unless it was checked, as it was checked by radical forces in many European countries, unless it was checked, its logical conclusion was Hitler and Mussolini. And it is a matter of great sadness that in India, it is this vision which ended up with Hitler and Mussolini, which is now being masqueraded in India as Indian nationalism. Those who are now masquerading, shouting about nationalism, nationalism, are borrowing this alien idea of Indian nationalism. This has got nothing to do, I emphasize, with the idea of India or with Indian nationalism. It's a foreign European notion which is being put down over our heads. The first challenge to the idea of India came at the time of the birth of the nation itself. I shall dwell in it for a few minutes because we can learn a lot of lessons from it for today. The spiral of communal violence beginning with the 1946 Calcutta killings, followed by the killings in Noakhali of Hindus, followed by the retaliatory killings, massive killings of Muslims in Bihar, created, and of course, the partition riots, where over 5 lakh people were killed, and some estimates are that about 60 lakh people were made homeless, refugees. One of the largest migrations of people in such a short period of time in human history. Now, this created a Holocaust-like situation. That is, communal frenzy was at its peak. The nationalist leaders at this time took up this challenge, led by Gandhiji, who stood like a rock, a one-man boundary force, as he was called, against communalism or communal riots by Mountbatten, and who paid with his life for this. The nationalists took up this challenge, and as I said, led from the front. Nehru, too, rose to his full stature to resist this challenge, putting his life at stake. His finest hour is this period, as a fellow historian has described it, that this was Nehru's finest hour. While Gandhiji spent 4 months walking the remote villages of Noakhali, trying to face the communal situation, at the same time when the negotiation of the transfer of power are occurring, one of the most eventful events of the 20th century in which Gandhiji had played a major role, he was not involved in that. He was involved in the villages, walking the villages day after day after day for continuously 4 months from 46 to February, March 47. He was doing this. Nehru on his part, as the Prime Minister of the interim government, landed up in Bihar with virtually his entire cabinet, Sardar Patel, Maulana Azad, Jayaprakash Narayan, Acharya Kripalani, just name it, everybody. All of them landed up in Bihar, and Nehru said, we will stay till the riots stop. And they did. He said in November 1946 in Bihar, I will stand in the way of Hindu-Muslim riots. Members of both communities will have to tread over my dead body if they try to strike at each other. What a contrast to what we witnessed today. Dadri happened 50 kilometers from Delhi, where a man is lynched, a man whose son fought in the Indian armed forces, is lynched on the mere suspicion of what meat he carries has in his fridge. What a contrast to where the Muzaffar Nagar ethnic cleansing occurs, where Muslims have yet not been able to get back to their religion. Where the Gujarat Janata got it. Where was the political intervention anywhere near the kind of political intervention we saw against communism at the point of the immediately after independence, on 19th August 1947, Nehru declares, our state is not a communal state, but a democratic state. How interesting. He is positing communalism versus democracy. So this understanding that democracy and communalism, you know, are contrasts, and that secular democracy come together, is a critical understanding. That is, when you oppose communalism, one must learn that one is simultaneously actually also fighting for democracy. And in fact, I would like to add a third element, which is often forgotten, that the umbilical cord connection between colonialism and communalism is also increasingly forgotten, especially as the communalists they masquerade as the genuine nationalists. So Nehru says, our state is not a communal state, but a democratic state in which every citizen has equal rights. The government is determined to protect these rights. But the notion of citizens having equal rights, of course, given the CAA and the NRC, etc., you must realize how important it was and how it was declared from the rooftops from the word go by Nehru, by Gandhiji repeatedly, that this is not a communal state. This is not a Hindu state. India is a state where every citizen has equal rights. Nehru saw Gandhiji's assassination in this general atmosphere, not as an act of a madman or a misled man, but an effort by an organization. He says it in so many words, and he names the organization. He says it's an effort by the RSS to change the very nature of the newly born Indian state. A very important understanding. He wrote to the chief ministers on February 5, 1948, a few weeks after, shortly after Gandhiji's assassination. He wrote, a deliberate coup d'etat, mind the words, a deliberate coup d'etat was planned involving killings of several persons and the promotion of general disorder to enable the RSS to seize power. It was an attempt, in other words, to create a mirror image of Muslim Pakistan, a Hindu India in our country. It was a threat to the very idea of India as a secular democratic country. And Nehru was not about to let it succeed. With full support of Patel, he banned the RSS, put 25,000 of their members in jail, and much more important, he converted the first general election, and I would like to highlight this, he converted the first general election into a virtual referendum on what was the nature of the Indian state going to be. Was it going to be secular democratic or was it going to be Hindu majoritarian? He traveled something like 40,000 kilometers and he did not have this 8,000 crore worth of planes that we have just recently bought for our prime minister. He traveled 40,000 kilometers. He spoke to 35 million people. That is one out of 10 people directly he spoke to, basically arguing this position. And the results were dramatic. And I want to emphasize that. in a peaceful, fair election held within 2 to 3 years of a Holocaust-like situation where extreme arousal of communal frenzy had occurred. We have this election in which the Hindutva forces, the Hindu Mahasabha, Jan Sangh, Ram Rajya Parishad, all of them put together got only 10 out of 489 seats. They got only 6% of the votes. That is, the overwhelming majority of the Indian people voted for a secular India. Whether they voted left, right, center, doesn't matter. But they voted for a secular India. It was a stunning achievement of which we need to be proud of. It was a tribute to the legacy of the Indian national movement that despite this trial by fire, so to speak, India did succeed in creating at the very beginning a secular India. The communal threat was pushed back for decades after Gandhiji's assassination and the first election. But unfortunately, as we have now realized, it was not extinguished. And India is paying a very heavy price today for this not being extinguished. In the last part of my lecture, I shall dwell on this question, that how is it that the Indian forces have again come to occupy center stage in India? Very briefly now, let us turn to how Nehru tackles the other elements of the idea of India. First, the issue of sovereignty. Nehru correctly understood that political independence by itself is not enough unless you also had economic and intellectual independence. Otherwise, you would be virtually a neo-colony. In 1950, for example, in order to generate any growth, if any investment had to be made, more than 90% of the equipment necessary for that investment had to be imported from the very countries from whom you just got political independence. This is the classic example of neocolonialism. More than 90% of not only machines, but even machine tools, your pliers and wrenches had to be imported at that time. This is what we were left with after 200 years of colonialism, a colonial economic structure. That is what Nehru inherits as the initial conditions. And he brilliantly tries to reverse it through what is now famously called the Nehru-Mahalanobis strategy. In the period 1950 to 65, industry grew at about 7% per annum, which is a magnificent rate of growth compared to the deindustrialization of the 19th century and a very slow growth after that before independence. But the more important part is not only that there was industrial growth, that the threefold increase in the aggregate production, industrial production that occurred in the Nehruvian period till about 1969, 70% of it was explained, of this increase in industrial production, was explained by increase in consumer goods. The increase in intermediate goods, things like steel, heavy chemicals, cement, etc., which are required for investment, quadrupled. And most important, the increase in capital goods production in this period increased by 10 times. There was a tenfold increase. This is what led to the structural transformation of the Indian economy in the very early two or three plans. That is, to give you one statistic which explains it, no amount of Nehru speeches will convince you more than his practice. We are so used to speeches and jumlas that I will be in most of my talk talking, giving Nehru's practice rather than his speeches. The result of this Nehruvian strategy was that more than from depending on import of machines and capital goods from advanced countries, almost entirely at independence, from nearly 100% dependence, by 1960, we had to import only 43% of machinery in order to make our fixed investments. And by 1974, we had to import only 9%. That is, by the 1970s, following the Nehruvian strategy, India was able to grow on its own to the extent of more than 90%. Its dependence on the external world, or particularly the advanced first world, had declined dramatically. This was, a stunning achievement. And it was critical for India's sovereignty. That's why I put it in the first category of the idea of India, attaining sovereignty. This was critical. This was critical for India to have an independent foreign policy. No amount of speeches in the United Nations could have achieved that. It is the fact that we had acquired this basic economic strength which enabled India to lead more than 100 countries in the non-aligned movement that Nehru had initiated. A whole foreign policy initiative which is being ridiculed in these days by people who know better. It was this unstructuring that occurred under the Nehruvian period, which in fact enabled India in the later years, particularly after the economic reforms, to participate in the globalization process with some advantage to itself. That is, it enabled them. This opening up did not lead to the complete submerging of the autonomy of the Indian economy. These, in other words, were not the wasted years. In the words of the neo-colonial neoliberals like Lord Meghnad Desai, who was once a Marxist but has now become a Modi Bhakt, he and Professor Tirthankar Roy, etc., have actually argued that the first 40 years of India's independence were wasted years. These were wasted years. These are not the wasted years. These are the years, in fact, all post-colonial societies had required these amount of years, 30 to 40 years, to unstructure their colonial structure before they could open up to the world capitalist system. China, which also got independence only 2 years after India, opened up only in 1978. So the world, the post-colonial world needed its Maos, it needed its Nehrus, it needed its Nassers, it needed its Sukarno. These were not wasted years. If India had opened up in 1950 the way it opened up in 1991, then we would have been a banana republic. It is because of what Nehru did in the first decades of after India's independence that we are witnessing the kinds of growth that we are witnessing today. It is not despite Nehru, but because of it. So there is a complete lie that has been spread, as I said, in the right-wing economic thinking. Another lie is about Nehru's ignoring agriculture, completely ignoring the fact that the institutional reforms in Indian agriculture, which reversed virtually 200 years of the baggage of colonial agriculture, the land reforms were brought in within a decade after independence. That is, the back of the zamindari system was broken within 10 years after independence, and that too within a democratic framework. The first three plans under Nehru witnessed an agricultural growth of 3% per annum, which was, believe you me, 8 times faster than the growth in agriculture in the previous 50 years. So to completely transform agriculture in a manner that you can grow 8 times faster happens under Nehru. It is also not true to say that one had to wait for Lal Bahadur Shastri to initiate the technological reforms which led to the Green Revolution. In fact, the facts are that even Nehru himself in his lifetime had seen the necessity of moving from institutional to technological reforms. And this intensive agricultural district program, which is the program which led to the Green Revolution, was started in his time. I'll just end this section by quoting one of the most famous economists who studied India at that time, Daniel Thorner. He, along with Wolf Ladejinski, are considered among the most knowledgeable people who were looking at Indian agriculture and land reforms. I'll just quote one line from him and rest the matter there. He says, "It is sometimes said that the initial 5-year plans neglected agriculture. This charge," he says, "cannot be taken seriously. The facts are that that India's first 21 years of independence, in those years, more has been done to foster change in agriculture, and more change has actually taken place than in the preceding 200 years. This is Daniel Thorner. An important thing to note is that this transformation that you see in industry and agriculture occurred with democracy. This was an unprecedented task, and Nehru, as well as others, were well aware of it, and they acknowledged that this was that India was moving on a path which, I'm quoting Nehru, which was uncharted in history. The transformation to industrialization that occurred in the rest of the world, or the agrarian revolution that occurred in the rest of the world, did not occur with democracy. It occurred with slavery, it occurred with the enclosure movement, with forced land tax, with forced collectivization, forced communes involving the killings of millions of people. It involved colonial surplus appropriation. It involved General MacArthur's army in Japan to do the land reforms, etc., etc. This path was not open to the Indian people. In India, the transition was not made on the backs of the working castes and the peasantry and the colonial people as it had been done in the past in the transition to modernity. A quick reference is necessary here to also Nehru's brilliant anticipation of the knowledge revolution. As early as the 1950s, Nehru is anticipating what is about to happen. And he focuses on science and technology, an area which was left virtually barren in the colonial period, very consciously. And as you, this is very well known, I won't spend time on it. Setting up of every institution that you know of in this area, the IITs, the National Physical Laboratory, National Chemical Laboratory, the Bhabha Atomic Research Center, just name it. All of these institutions were started from the 1950s onwards under Nehru's guidance. And it's the fruits of this that we are witnessing today. That the fact that India is in fact able to participate in the information revolution to whatever extent that we can. The fact that the most dynamic sector in India today is the services sector, which is essentially based on the information technology, is because of Nehru, not because he anticipated it. It is not despite Nehru. This is also, I also want to nail another lie. This notion that Nehru did only higher education, ignored primary education. Again, a complete lie. You know, Nehru was one of the key architects of the 1931 Karachi Resolution, which anticipates, in fact, in many ways, the Indian Constitution, in which basic free and compulsory education was a very key component. The destruction of the public school system, that is the government school system, and in fact, even the public health system that has occurred in recent years cannot be put on Nehru's back. All our parents and grandparents, in fact, emerged out of this school and college system that was there in Nehru's time. Rather than building on the public education and health system that emerged in Nehruvian times, what we have witnessed in the recent past, particularly since the 1980s and 90s, is a destruction of this, wanton destruction of this system, conscious destruction of this system in order to bring in the private and the foreign. This is the neoliberal model that your new education policies are trying to do essentially that, bring in private and foreign and deny to the Indian poor, their only source of social mobility, which is education. So that education is now not accessible to our vast majority of our people. I mean, quality education. This brings me to the next idea of the next element in the idea of India, which is the pro-poor aspect of the idea of India. Nehru's success in keeping India on the democratic civil libertarian path against considerable odds, as you are aware, most post-colonial countries were not able to keep on to the democratic civil libertarian path. But Nehru's success in doing so by itself ensured that the poor were not left out entirely from the development process. With 70,000 newspapers and more than 700 satellite channels, no large-scale famine could be hidden in India. As Amartya Sen has been emphasizing repeatedly, that democracy is the ultimate guarantor of the poor. He said, without democracy and civil liberties, you cannot guarantee even the life of the poor. And he gives the example of China, where more than 20 to 60 million people died of famine and the world did not know because there was no free press. While political democracy was understood by Nehru to be a necessary condition for people's empowerment, it was by no means taken to be sufficient. As he put it in 1952, I'm quoting him, if poverty and low standards continue, then democracy, for all its fine institutions and ideals, ceases to be a liberating force. It must therefore aim continuously at the eradication of poverty. In other words, political democracy is not enough. it must develop into economic democracy also, unquote. The community development program and later attempts to integrate it with the Panchayati Raj institutions were efforts in empowering the poor, though, as we know, it took the 73rd and the 74th amendment decades after Nehru even to try and give some teeth to these. Nehru was deeply influenced by Marxism since the late. His contribution in embedding and then making widely acceptable the socialist ideal of empowering the poor among the Indian people was immense. The fact that not only the communists and socialists, but an overwhelming majority of nationalist opinion in India since the late 1930s accepted socialism as an objective was to a great extent because of Nehru. So deeply did this idea get rooted among the Indian people as a whole that as late as 1980, when the decidedly right-wing Jansang, which had nothing to do with socialism or the national movement, was reborn in its new avatar as the Bharatiya Janata Party, it chose to declare itself, believe you me, as Gandhian Socialist Party. The successors of the murder of and those who think socialism is a dirty one were calling themselves Gandhian socialists because that idea had got so deeply embedded. Nehru was able to give the socialist ideal such wide acceptability in India, partly because, and this is important, he made a very early break from a narrow, sectarian, rigid interpretation of Marxism, which India's leading historian of modern and contemporary India, Professor Bipin Chandra, had called Stalin Marxism. Nehru was among the first in the world to make this break from Stalin Marxism, roughly at the same time as the famous Italian Marxist Antonio Gramsci. The same time as Gramsci. In the late 1930s, Nehru was groping for a strategy of social transformation along with Gramsci in a democratic and semi-democratic framework, which was different from the insurrectionary and violent Bolshevik model that they felt was not suitable to such situations of democratic, semi-democratic situations. Eurocommunism made this breakthrough popular as late as the 1970s, but Nehru had made this breakthrough in the 1930s. Nehru was fortunate in being witness to and part of the Gandhian struggle for freedom, which was till then and perhaps remains till today the only actual historical example of a semi-democratic or democratic type state structure being replaced or transformed, of the broadly Gramscian theoretical perspective of a war of position being successfully practiced. The fact that Gramsci saw this as the only possible strategy for social transformation in the developed countries of the West underlines the huge significance of the Gandhian movement and to this understanding of socialism to the world as a whole. Learning from the practice of the Gandhian movement made it easier for Nehru to break from the Stalin Marxist paradigm and argue somewhat precociously that while there could be no true democracy without socialism, there could be no socialism, he said, without democracy. As the world has now realized it to be true, but he was among the first to say so. He insisted that civil liberty and democracy had to be a basic part of socialism. The socialist transformation, he said, required societal consensus, the consent of the overwhelming majority of the people. It could not be a minority revolution led by a handful of highly committed revolutionaries. It could not be, in other words, be just, quote unquote, a dictatorship of the proletariat. It was also not enough just to have a majority. To succeed, he said, it had to be a socialism acceptable to all sections by an overwhelming majority. Nehru was anticipating what later events were to validate and what was to be slowly accepted globally by increasingly sections of the left. Though at that time, until much later in India, Nehru was ridiculed for his ideas on socialism. Nehru was to retain throughout his life this nuanced, persuasive style of functioning while remaining resolute in his goals, which brought him the support, love, and admiration of millions in a manner which was surpassed only by Gandhiji. And as a true disciple of the master, while appealing to all sections of society, he succeeded in keeping the gaze focused on the poor, the oppressed, and the disadvantaged. His great achievement was that he got a very large part of Indian society, individuals and institutions, to share his socialist vision. In the Nehruvian period, from the planning commission to the public sector bureaucracy, to the media, to popular films, the socialist objective was seen as a desirable one. It was not defined it was not then, of course, defined in any narrow fundamentalist way, but in the way that Nehru broadly outlined it. Socialism was not a dirty word, as it is attempted to be made out today. Also, the obscene inequality and total disregard and disrespect for the poor that we have witnessed today, particularly during the pandemic, when the whole world watched the wretched poor of this country walk hundreds of miles to their villages on roads with the temperatures soaring above 40 degrees, with the children dragging their children and their old with them, many dying in the process, was unthinkable in Nehruvian times. The depths we have fallen on this issue, on this idea of India, of respect for the poor, of identifying the poor as the people of this country, which was the Nehru's notion of Bharat Mata, that is all gone. Lastly, before I move on to the current situation, a brief word on Nehru's critical contribution to the building and nurturing of the institutions of a functioning democracy. It's important because that is exactly what is being dismantled at the moment. The parliament, something that Nehru respected, not only by doing Shashtang Pranam in front of it, but actually by being in parliament whenever there was a debate, particularly if there was a critique, and particularly of him and his policies, unlike the prime minister coming on the first and the last day, as happens now. A proper cabinet system. Many of his cabinet ministers have said in their memoirs that how Nehru would insist that they exercise their autonomy and did not keep coming running to him saying that you guide us. A free press, critical to democracy, and most important for Jawaharlal Nehru, a vibrant opposition. Not as it is today. An opposition mukt Bharat was not his goal. For him, democracy meant a vibrant opposition. This is too large a country with too many diversities to permit any so-called strong man to trample over the people and their lives. He said further, I do not want India to be a country in which millions of people say yes to one man. I want a strong opposition. And that one man he's referring to is himself. When he found that not enough opposition was coming to himself, he famously would write articles critiquing himself with a pseudonym. I'll quote just one such article, which he wrote in the late 1930s. He apparently did the same in the 1950s as well, where he talks of his being, when he's being, there is talk of his being elected for the third time as the Congress, Indian National Congress president. He warns the people in an article written in the name of Chanakya. He warns the people rather precociously, considering what is happening today, that India should not countenance any tendency towards the emergence of a dictator or any one strong man emerging using his popularity, which is what he was, using the languages and slogans of democracy and socialism, which he used a lot. And then he goes on to say, we all know how fascism has fattened on this language. Amazing prescience. This language has been used and is being used today, as you know, to bring in elements of fascism, as I will discuss in the concluding section of my talk. This brings me to the Indian situation today. What is it that has brought our country into the situation where we are faced with what has been correctly, in my opinion, described as communal fascism? Despite the heroic battle against it at the time of independence, fought by Nehru and Gandhi and his associates. Despite Nehru's repeated warning that if fascism came to India, it will take the form of majority communalism. I have time, because I've already taken too much time, I have time just to list a few of what appear to me to be some of the reasons which has led to the current denouement. Where is it that we failed? In my opinion, the most important factor in the survival and reassertion of the communal forces was the fact that the secular forces failed to undertake any sustained ideological work combating the communal ideology. Nor were they able to use state power to contain the communal forces. The Hindu communalists led by the RSS, as well as the minority communalists among the Sikhs and the Muslims, continued their propaganda, including in the education system. After the 25,000 RSS workers were released, the RSS very soon again started propaganda among the people, now through schools that they set up, the Shishuniketas that they set up all over the country, hundreds of them, through their schools and their shakas, and have written a book on the subject. They spread poison in the minds of young children about the minority community and about our Indian national revolutionary struggle. The only exception was in the 1960s, when the Indian state made an effort through the NCERT to bring to our children scientific, modern, secular, non-communal, non-colonial textbooks written by some of our tallest historians, people like R.S. Sharma, Romila Thapar, Bipin Chandra, Satish Chandra, etc. Books which have all been removed, as you know, under pressure from the right-wing communal forces. More shocking was what happened when the communal forces, when they, especially after 1999, when they actually came to power in the center, when they used their power, state power, to rapidly communalize the education system. And when state power was used to enable something like the Gujarat genocide to happen. After this, when the secular forces came back to power on the slogan of de-Talibanizing education, on the slogan of fighting for secularism, when they came back to power and stayed in power for 10 long years, 2004 to 2014, very little, as you are aware, was done to combat communalism as an ideology. Many other things, good things, bad things may have been done. But this did not remain the central agenda, even after the experience of those 5 years. And even after what Nehru had repeatedly written to his chief ministers immediately after the independence. He was warning against the virulent communal propaganda through newspapers, rumors, etc., that was taking place, often leading to riots. Nehru urged immediate action against such newspapers and their editors, spreading communal hatred, and against police officials and district magistrates for inaction during riots. He urged, I'm quoting Nehru, proper compensation must be paid to the riot victims. And I'm quoting, it was essential that the guilty be punished and should be made to feel that it does not pay to create disturbance and to loot and to kill. Yet, since the 1950s, 60s, and much more so today, hardly any organizer or perpetrator of communal riots or the spreader of communal poison is punished or put behind the bars. Virulent communal propaganda continues unabated till today. So this is my first objection, reason I think why where we are today. The second is the ruling regimes like the Congress, which ruled for most of the post-independence period in the center, as well as the left, which ruled for long decades in many provinces, they suffered from what one would call an element of economism. That is, if only we had economic development, if the temples of modern India were to become the dams and the bridges and the steel plants and industries, etc., then somehow this backward communal ideology would fade away. There was this assumption that economic development would do it, or economic class struggles would lead to the diminution of communal thinking. Now, both of these have proved to be wrong. Communalism has spread in fact, largely in the economically more developed areas, and the working class movements, the working class, when it is faced with the worst of it, of the situations, have often turned to communalism rather than to trade union movements. So it is not necessary. It needed something more. My first point, the ideological battle was to be launched. Thirdly, the secular forces, again, unfortunately, including the left, often made compromises, some compromises. They did not play the communal game, but made compromises with communal forces in order to gain some short-term electoral gains. When a people are already communalized, appealing to their communal perceptions will get you some more votes. So rather than fight in the long run to change their perception, it was appealing to those perceptions that was resorted to across the board. A particular weakness in this regard was softness towards the minority communalism. This was a major evil or ill that was practiced by, again, across the board, including the left, unfortunately. A heavy price, I think, was paid for ignoring the sage advice given by Jawaharlal Nehru, again, as early as the 1930s, that one cannot use one variety of communalism to combat the other. The plea that the minorities are oppressed or that they are being treated unkindly, etc., does not give you the license to practice minority communalism or support minority communalism. If the minorities are oppressed, then you have to practice secular politics, not minority communal politics. As Nehru said, one communalism does not end the other. He said, each feeds on the other and both fatten. Softness towards minority communalism has made the growth of majority communalism much easier today. Fourthly, the secular forces outside the Congress, including the left, in their desperation to dislodge the Congress, often tended to line up opportunistically with avowedly communal forces. That is, communal parties, which were untouchable immediately after independence, suddenly were now seen as partners in trying to overthrow the existing Congress government. This happened since the late 60s onwards. But the first major instance, which I'll give you only two examples, major instance of this was the JP movement, which joined hands with the RSS in an effort to overthrow the elected Congress government of Indira Gandhi in the years, I'm underlining, before the declaration of the emergency in 1975. They joined hands with the RSS. And when JP was questioned that, what about the fascist nature of the RSS? JP said, the Jan Sangh and the RSS, I'm quoting him, are neither fascist. The Jan Sangh and the RSS are neither reactionary nor fascist. If the Jan Sangh and RSS are fascist, then I too am a fascist. Now, what better certificate could you give to the communal fascist forces? The result of this was that the RSS, as you know, merged with the Janata Party, the Jan Sangh. And when the Janata Party came to power, for the first time in India's history since independence, the communal forces came close to central power in the country. And a power which was used immediately to attack the secular mentality. The first thing that the 1977 government did was to try to ban the secular textbooks that had been brought in the 1960s by the NCERT. The same error was again repeated, this is my second example, in 1989, when the VP Singh led Janata Dal, shockingly, along with the support of the left, made an alliance with the Bharatiya Janata Party, to the BJP, to overthrow the Congress government of Rajiv Gandhi. The BJP thus acquired acceptability, respectability in Indian politics. They shot up from 2 seats in 1984 to 86 in 1989. The trajectory of the meteoric rise of the BJP since then is now history. The fifth error, I would say, which explains the current situation, is the seeding of the nationalist space by the secular forces, and thus by seeding that space, enabling the communal, anti-national, communal forces to grab that nationalist space. The very acceptance of the self-description of the majority communalists as Hindu nationalists was a grave error. Throughout the national movement, this description was never accepted by anybody. The Hindu communalists were called communalists, not Hindu nationalists. This was made fashionable by the French historian, political scientist, Christopher Jaffrelot, who continuously referred to them as Hindu nationalists and has now become common parlance. Every journalist you meet is talking about Hindu nationalism. You've already allowed them to use the word nationalists by a set of people who are deeply divisive, who destroy the nation. But apart from that, and this again, when Jawaharlal Nehru repeatedly warns against this, from very early, and not once, many times, Jawaharlal Nehru says, majority communalism can easily masquerade as nationalism. It masquerades under a nationalist cloak. This is his words. He says, Hindu nationalism is but another name for communalism. The betrayal of the freedom struggle, denial of every vestige of nationalism, suppressive of every manly instinct in the Hindus. This is what he says is Hindu nationalism. The current masculine, aggressive, alpha male nationalism that is being paraded by the Hindutva forces was squarely characterized by Nehru and the Indian national movement leaders as anti-national and communal. Also, the secular forces have made it easier for the communalists to occupy the nationalist space by themselves neglecting, critiquing, and even ridiculing our national liberation struggle. The condemning of Gandhi, Patel, Tilak, Nehru, etc., not Nehru, Aurobindo, etc., as communal or semi-communal, calling them bourgeois agents and agents of the bourgeoisie, and if not of imperialism itself. There was a phase then when Gandhi and Nehru were called agents of imperialism. And mind you, in recent academic writings, it continues to be done till today, including from the left. All you have to do is pick up this book by Perry Anderson, editor of the New Left Review for such a long period of time, called The Indian Ideology, where he ridicules Nehru and Gandhi and the Indian National Movement using the very digits of the colonial description of the Indian National Movement. That is, this was an upper caste Baniya party, Brahmin, Brahmiya, Baniya combination, fighting for their little prescriptive advantages and did not represent the people. This is Lord Dufferin, that the national movement represent the microscopic minority. But this view was popularized in a large spectrum of Indian academia, including among the left. The need of the hour was, on the other hand, quite something different. It was to own up the ancestry of the great legacy of our national movement, one of the most powerful national liberation struggles in the world. And then standing on the shoulders of this legacy, one needed to make further breakthroughs. Instead, what was done was its rejection. Its rejection made it easy for the communalists to appropriate that legacy. We handed over the legacy of our national movement to the communalists. It made it easy for them to say, okay, you don't want them, they are our leaders. So here are people who had no ancestry in the national liberation struggle, now claim them as their ancestors. Lastly, there has been a paradigmatic change in recent years in the threat of the communal forces posed to the secular democratic vision. And that paradigmatic change is the use of state power. From the 50s, 60s, 70s, You saw communal ideology being spread, but they were never in state power. But this is a new phenomenon. Having seized governmental power, the BJP agenda has now become to change the character of the Indian state itself. Government power doesn't change the nature of the state. The fact that the BJP, which believes in Hindu Rashtra and Hindutva, has not made India into a Hindu state yet. The nature of the state has not been converted. So their agenda is now to use state power to convert the Indian state into a Hindu state. Now that requires changing the character of all the instruments of state power, the bureaucracy, the judiciary, the police, the education system, the media, all of that has to be changed, and also civil society. And it cannot be done without repression. It cannot be done without complete control over the media and the education system, and by punishing those who oppose these efforts, which means it could not be done without force. Their regime, therefore, automatically pushes towards a fascist character. Here again, if I may take you back to Nehru. Nehru was one of the first to connect fascism with communalism. In the late 30s itself, he began to describe the Muslim League as a party which was acquiring fascist techniques and fascist methods. And by the 1940s, especially after independence, as I've referred to you earlier, he was clearly seeing the RSS as representing a fascist force. I'm quoting him now. In December 1947, he writes to the chief ministers. He says, "We have a great deal of evidence to show that the RSS is an organization which is in the nature of a private army and which is definitely proceeding on the strictest Nazi lines." This is Jawaharlal Nehru. "Even following the techniques of organization of the Nazis." After Gandhiji's murder, Nehru was even more convinced of this. Even after the ban on the RSS was lifted, and I've discussed this earlier already, Nehru warns his chief ministers again. He says, "Reports reach us that RSS is again resuming some of its activities, and it must always be remembered that the whole mentality of the RSS is a fascist mentality. Therefore, their activities have to be closely watched." Majority communalism, Nehru argued, could disguise itself as nationalism and the Indian version of fascism, and therefore deserves severest condemnation. We paid a very heavy price for ignoring this connection. I will end by bringing to your attention some of the common features of the fascist method, which has been recently highlighted by a brilliant book, which many of you must have read, by a philosopher of Yale University, Professor Jason Stanley, called How Fascism Works, where he looks at many countries which has moved in the direction of fascism. And he just picks up some of what he thinks are elements that show that a country is moving in that direction. And I thought I will, for this audience, list some of them. And you will, as you are aware of the contemporary situation in India, automatically see the connections. He says, Stanley says, the fascist resort to the creation of an idyllic mythic past, that we had this great past, completely mythological. I mean, I'm sure you recognize this, that we in the ancient past knew everything from plastic surgery to, as the Bengal governor said, Arjuna having a nuclear tipped arrow, etc., to aeroplanes. Everything was known to us. A great past, number one. Number two, setting up an elaborate propaganda machinery. I don't have to talk about that. You are aware of how brilliantly it is being done in India. Number three, using the propaganda machinery, and this is important, to create a sense of victimhood in the majority. That is, the majority, the powerful, are now suddenly made to feel the victims, that they are under attack. Like the Jews were seen as the danger to the German race itself. So the Muslims are now seen in India, are projected as those who are multiplying rapidly and with the help of infiltrators from outside, the Ghuspetias, as the Home Minister calls them, like termites, thousands of them will come and they will dominate the Hindu majority. So this fear among the Hindu majority is being created. Fourthly, fascists resort to the creation of a sense of sexual anxiety. Are you aware of how love jihad has suddenly become such an important matter from the judiciary down to the street level shaka worker? Everybody is talking of love jihad. Next, the equating of the majority with the nation and the minorities as the anti-national. In the RSS lexicon, and we have listed it, the Muslims and the Christians have been listed for a long time in their textbooks as people who are to be watched, that they are anti-national. The equating, and the next, again, very, very important, the equating of the government with the notion, with the nation. This is a very important element of us. The government is equated to the nation, and the corollary of that is that the leader of this government, leader with a capital L, is also equated to the nation. So anyone who dissents from the government or dissents with the leader, critiques the leader, is declared as anti-national. And thus, his right to be a citizen is to be taken away. Now, this equating of the leader and the government to the nation is straight out of Mussolini. The critics of the leader, as you know, or the government, are today called, including us, Deshdrohis. I'm sure Subhash is one of them. Tukde Tukde Gang, Urban Naxal, Lutyens Delhi, or Khan Market Gang. And the last two are targeted against the educated elite, which is the next element in the fascist armory. They target the intelligentsia. They target the universities. The story of how Hitler attacked Frankfurt University, which was the premier university in Germany, is well known, and it has been written about by the famous management guru, Peter Drucker, who was then a student there or faculty and had to run away to the United States. The same thing is done here. The manner in which my university, Jawaharlal Nehru University, has been attacked, its teachers, its students, its independence, its, you know, it's a university which has been ranked as number one for decades now by the government itself. But it has been called a university which produces anti-nationals, Deshdrohis, et cetera, to such an extent that in 2016, when the campaign was built up with the help of the media, auto rickshaws and taxi drivers refused to bring you to Jawaharlal Nehru University, saying that we don't take people to Pakistan. So a vilification of the education institutions and of the intelligentsia, targeting. And I don't need to give you too many examples of this. This constant vilification and of people of the intelligentsia as anti-nationals then begins to justify their repression, their imprisonment, their expulsion, and in certain cases their death, if not genocide. So from Gauri Lankesh's to Professor Kalburgi, to being actually killed, to the Sudha Bharadwaj and such like being in prison for 2 years, a professor of mathematics. The only evil that she did was that she did law and fought for the poor tribal workers. So in jail, without trial. And even Gandhians who are committed to nonviolence, people like Harshmandar, are under attack. Prashant Bhushan, of course, is another one of those. So the examples multiply of this attack on the intelligentsia, the people who can lead the thought process. But perhaps the most important distinguishing feature of a fascist regime from just any other authoritarian regime is the creation of a band of what Jason Stanley calls, quote, dehumanized segments of the population. Bands of dehumanized segments of the population, that is, the stormtroopers, who carry out the task of targeting, attacking, and even elimination of the so-called anti-nationals, while the state machinery just benignly looks on. Now, do I need to give examples of this? The bands of people that roam this country today, borrowing some name or the other from the Hindu tradition, they add it to their names, and then they go about assaulting, lynching, murdering people, sometimes with police help, sometimes without, but certainly without any action being taken against them. The country needs to learn, friends, from the practice of fascism elsewhere and the signs, the fascist signs that are emerging in our own country. And the most important lesson that we can learn as a historian, I can say to you, from the history of fascism, is that fascism can be resisted only if all forces unite against it. It is no longer a fight between the right and the left. It is a fight between one of the greatest achievements of human civilization, democracy, and barbarism. And in this fight, everybody needs to come together. It is the absence of coming together in Germany, as you know. Even the socialists and communists did not come together, which led to the rise of Hitler. The pity, unfortunately, is that despite all the signs staring us in the face, as I've just described to you, this lesson has yet to be learned by the democratic forces in India. They have not yet internalized this lesson. They need to put aside all other differences and unite at this point of time to defeat this, what is the word, shall I say, this pestilence that has hit our country. Pestilence not only in the sense of a medical illness, but a political illness that has visited our country. Thank you so much for your patience.
Thank you very much, Professor Aditya Mukherjee, for a brilliant presentation and for underlining the limits of left intervention. And I'm extremely sorry for the initial hiccup we had. Some hackers had come and they just demonstrated that Nehru, after his death of death, still frightens them. Still frightens them. That was the power of Nehru. And I'm extremely sorry because of the initial disturbance we had. There are very few questions in the chat box. But before I take the questions in the chat box, I would like to invite Kumar Ketkar. He is with us, he's a member of parliament. And if he can give a comment or read the question, it will be really, really wonderful. Kumar Ketkar, sir. I think he's... So, in the meanwhile, I ask Professor S.S.P. Singh to raise a question.
Hello.
Please.
Thank you, sir. Definitely, it's a brilliant presentation, very comprehensive, and taking into account the overall contribution of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru and the present crisis. I have just a query regarding the comment that he made regarding the JP movement and the inclusion of, you know, definitely the communal forces against the authoritarian regime, obviously this is Indira Gandhi. What I want to say that, was it not, necessary at the time how to save democracy against the authoritarian style of functioning of Mrs. Gandhi? And therefore, whatever the compulsions at the time, JP could not, exclude the people who are, communal throughout the beginning of the, period. And definitely what statement that he made during that period, definitely he may have regretted about that kind of statement that he made regarding if RSS is a fascist, I'm also a fascist. But definitely immediate threat to save democracy was, very important at the time. And therefore, somehow communal forces took advantage, which is a sustained threat to Indian democracy even today. You have already made that fighting against the fascist forces all have to be united. I think at that time, that was the time where JP wanted to unite all the people who were against the authoritarianism of Mrs. Indira Gandhi. That I want to make, sir. Thank you.
You want me to respond question. And
please respond. Please respond. Yeah.
Mr. Singh, that is why I underlined the fact that this alliance with the RSS was made before the declaration of the emergency. It is in the period before the declaration of the emergency when there was an elected government of Indira Gandhi. You may not like her. You may not like the way she functioned, etc., for whatever reason. But would that be a good enough reason to join hands with a clearly fascist communal force to overthrow Indira Gandhi? That is the question. Even after that, that is why I'm repeating Jawaharlal Nehru. Remember Gandhiji, in fact, Gandhiji much more than anybody else, that your means, whatever be the good ends that you may have in mind, if your means are evil, then you never achieve that good end. You cannot use whatever instrument, however evil that is, for an end which you think is good. By doing that, you in fact institutionalize that evil. And that is what has happened in India. That is the actual path that it took.
We have with us Vasanthi Ramanji also. So I request her to share her comments and or create a question. Please, Vasanthi ji.
Thank you so much. I unfortunately, in the early stages, I missed the thing because it took me a while to connect. But of course, it has been a very, what shall I say? It's so timely that we need to remind ourselves. In fact, some of us who have been discussing the issue of the emergency and the role of JP and the legitimacy that has been given to the RSS, because we were all part of the anti-emergency movement. And at that time, we never thought about, because the only issue was that we needed to get rid of the authoritarian rule of the Congress. So, but now, when we look back, and many books, articles have come on this issue, highlighting the role of the RSS and the visibility, the legitimacy that was given to them through participation in the JP movement. And it is indeed, for many of us, it is shocking, because we were all part, we suffered during the emergency, we were imprisoned, but we never, it's now that we look back, because I think there is no, I often tell people that whenever there have been discussions, I said the emergency was like a song compared to what we are going through now, because the hatred, the politics of hatred and the politics of divisiveness, we never saw anything like that during the emergency period. So I do think we need to look back at these questions, because at every stage in our post-independence history, this issue, because the RSS has been preparing for it for the last nearly 100 years. And we have underestimated that. And I think that's something, if India has to remain together, unfortunately, the partition happened, but this is something we need to look really carefully. This is what we, if we want to save this country and a democratic and socialist and vision, secular vision, then we need to address the whole question of the role of the RSS, and it has really spread like poison over this land. This is all I have to say.
I would like to add, sir, to what Vasanthi said.
Please. And I would like to hear Kumar Ketkarji also.
Kumar Ketkarji. One second, please.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I have a feeling that actually Nehru was opposed from within the Congress and out.
Hello.
I think he's lost.
He's gone. Kumar Ketkarji.
It was a form of syndicate. And later on, the same struggle was continued with Jayaprakash Narayan as the leader. So Jayaprakash Narayan carried forward the syndicate's policy or the anti-Nehruvian approach which began at the time of independence. So I think it is a continuation from Jayaprakash from syndicate to Jayaprakash Narayan to VP Sen.
There's some problem with this thing. Please, Professor Mukherjee, would you like to add something to it?
No. I want to hear what you are going to say.
The stage, that on the stage, demanding action, and the parliament was forced to salute Anna Hazare, and that I think was the beginning of the new form of fascism in the country.
The last line, that Anna Hazare line, what did you say? We did not hear you. The connectivity got disturbed.
Kumar Ketkar ji, can you please repeat yourself? The last point I wanted to know.
Hello?
Your voice was not clear, sir.
That's the last, I don't last. Know what. My only point was the syndicate Congress attack on Nehru was actually brewing even before.
There's some problem with this connection. I will ask some. If Didip, Are you adding, sir? Kumar ji?
No. Yeah, hello?
Please.
If you understood my question, that's all right.
Acha. So could you get, sir? From Mukherjee, could you get his question? I don't know.
I get the question. I got the general drift that the link between the syndicate and what has happened since then and the other JP and etc. That of course is well taken. But he made a comment about Anna Hazare movement, which I was keen to hear, if he can hear me.
So there are few more questions.
Your own point, I interrupted you. I think Subhashji, you were going to say something.
No. I'm just sharing the questions which are there in the chat box. One sec. There is a question that you you talked about. One Praveen Kumar has raised a question that when you say that India has no nationalism on its own, so I want to ask, with reference to anti-Bengal partition protest and Swadeshi movement, it is said that there was the sentiment of nationalism. Slogans of Vande Mataram acknowledged in every nook and corner of Kolkata. His question is, how do you compare it? The feeling of nationalism was there, and he's talking about the Bengal partition of Bengal. So, small question.
I would be the last person to say that there was no feeling of nationalism. Far from it. All that I argued was that the nationalism that was created in this country, and of course the Swadeshi movement was very much a part of it, was of a completely different kind from the nationalism that you saw emerging there, and how it ended up in the Hitler Mussolini type of nationalism. I was only counterposing this, far from saying that there was no feeling of nationalism. And of course, the content of that nationalism, the content of Vande Mataram and the content of Bharat Mata is being hijacked. And now a completely anti-national activity and even murders are being made in this name, in Ram's name, in Bharat Mata's name.
We have with us Kali Chitti Babu. I request him to raise. Please. Oh, I'm not able to unmute you. Please, sir.
Sir, it is today's talk is very excellent by Mukherjee, sir. since I am part of JNU Teachers Association, I could relate it to the today's lecture. The kind of attacks are being on JNU. Really, the idea should be taken forward to the public in a larger manner. It should not confine to this only the groups that we are actually connecting to. Because now I really request from this forum to Mukherjee sir for these ideas should be actually to reach to the pro-poor. What the pro-poor idea is actually was the main idea for the making the modern Indian for this country. So that these ideas should be reached to the public, because the public was completely is given with a kind of lies. Today you continuously say lie, all the lies every day. These lies are actually manipulating the public, and then today they are more concerned about these lies, not the food, employment, anything. So I really appreciate Mukherjee sir, if you could really take these ideas to the larger mass through any medium, because this initiative, really I congratulate you for taking this initiative, because if you are really take this to the public, it will really helpful. Because I'm really today I learned so much from today's talk. So this is what I wanted to just speak.
Very, very important thing you added. There is one question from Mr. Sanjay Srivastav. What about the nature of people as distinct from the nature of the state? We hardly get any analysis of the nature of the people. Can a fascist government survive unless very large number of the people share that ideology? Are we not, as you have demonstrated, a state-driven society, and with a different party in power, we in effect will get a different society? Do we tend to romanticize the idea of the Indian people without much empirical evidence of what their beliefs are? Please.
I could not agree with you more that civil society and the people are extremely important, and that they constitute a critical element in what a state is. That is the difference between the what we think is bad political science, where you equate the state with the government. Government is just one instrument of the state. The state is the government, the other state machinery, the judiciary, the bureaucracy, the education system, the media, all of that plus civil society. That is what the state is. And that is what I was saying in my lecture, that having captured governmental power, this regime now wants to change the character of the other instruments of the state, and much more so of civil society itself. That is, they want to poison civil society. And the resistance, therefore, has to come first from the civil society. I would be in total agreement with you that is the central area where one needs to function. And the job of the intelligentsia is precisely as it has been in our past. Our civil society is what it is today because the tremendous job the Indian intelligentsia did from the mid-19th century onwards. Half a century of intense intellectual activity among the civil society. Now that is the kind of intelligentsia or intervention that we require from the intelligentsia, rather than dream of how to migrate to the United States, which most of our educated people do today.
We have Professor Karen Gabriel with us, so I have requested to share her comment, her question. Karen Gabriel. I think she's not there. Sadhna Arya, she's a professor at Satyavati College. I request her to raise a question and give a comment. Sadhna ji.
Yeah, Professor Aditya, आपका analysis से मैं लगभग हर हद तक उससे सहमत हूँ. लेकिन मुझे लगता है कि हम एक प्रेजेंट सिचुएशन जिसमें है उसमें एनालिसिस के साथ साथ आगे कैसे पढ़ा जाए, और खासतौर से जब हम ये कह रहे हैं कि इस कम्युनलाइजेशन, इस पोलराइजेशन, इस डिविजिवनेस ने समाज के किसी सेक्शन को नहीं छोड़ा है, लाइक फ्रॉम द पुअर वर्किंग क्लास पीपल, फ्रॉम पीपल फ्रॉम अदर मार्जिन्स ऑफ सोसाइटी एंड फ्रॉम द एजुकेटेड एलीट। अगर हम सभी एक पूरा स्पेक्ट्रम देखें तो इससे इस तरह से इम्पेक्ट हुआ है कि इसमें से रास्ता निकालना बहुत मुश्किल हो रहा है। और जिस तरह से मीडिया को इसके लिए, मतलब मीडिया इज नो मोर अ फोर्थ वट एवर पिलर ऑफ डेमोक्रेसी, इज इट्स नो मोर देयर। तो इन परिस्थितियों में हम जब ये कहते हैं कि ऑल डेमोक्रेटिक फोर्सेज हैव टू कम टुगेदर, मैं शायद बहुत एक डेस्पेयर की सिचुएशन में ये बात कह रही हूँ कि वेयर आर द डेमोक्रेटिक फोर्सेज। पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज में अगर हम देखें तो हमें कितनी पार्टीज हैं जो डेमोक्रेटिक तरीके से काम करती हुई भी नजर आ रही हैं और एक अल्टरनेटिव क्रिएटिव तरीके से इश्यूज को एड्रेस करना चाह रही हैं। दे आर जस्ट एम्युलेटिंग व्हाट बीजेपी इज डूइंग। ओके, वो आपने भी शायद बात कही है। और अगर डेमोक्रेटिक फोर्सेज का मायना है जो हम आज लोग बैठे हुए हैं यहाँ पर, या कुछ और इस तरह के प्रोग्रेसिव ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस, ह्यूमन राइट्स ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस, वो कितना चैलेंज दे पा रहे हैं ये भी हमारे सामने है। तो इन दिस सिचुएशन ऑफ डेस्पेयर, आई एम नॉट सेइंग कि कोई आप ब्लूप्रिंट मेरे सामने रखें, ऑब्वियसली अगेन वी हैव टू एनालाइज एंड वी हैव टू वर्क टुवर्ड्स दैट, बट इट्स रियली ग्रेट सिचुएशन ऑफ डेस्पेयर, जबकि हम देखते हैं कि समाज का कोई भी सेक्शन नहीं बचा है जो कि इसका इसमें अब इस तरह से घुस नहीं गया है कि उसको निकालना बहुत मुश्किल हो रहा है। मतलब डू वी रियली नीड अ सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर टू हॉल्ट दिस प्रोसेस? बिकॉज दैट्स हाउ, इफ आई एम नॉट रॉन्ग, हिटलर एंड मुसोलिनी वर स्टॉप्ड, यू नो। सो वेयर इज इट दैट वी आर हेडिंग?
आपने बहुत गंभीर सवाल किया है और बिल्कुल मैं आपसे पूरी तरह सहमत हूँ, एक्सेप्ट दैट आई डू नॉट थिंक that we need to despair. Historian होने के नाते, and that is what I was trying to continuously, in fact, bring to your attention, that similar situation, much worse situations, were faced in by our national leaders and by the Indian intelligentsia, not only in 1947. When you say that the media is captured, what was the media and what was the power of the state in the early 20th century or late 19th century? It was the most powerful state in the world, a state on which the sun never set. That is, the British Empire was ruling you. What was the strength of your media? What did you have? You know, pamphlets that you could write. In that situation, a handful of people, if they could survive. Let us learn from that experience. That is, as I said, rather than rubbish our national liberation struggle, if we were able to see how they were able to link with ordinary people, how they were lived, able to join hands despite this enormous diversity. जो मैंने कहा कि जो idea of India पे जब consensus बना ली, हालांकि इतने सारे streams थे हमारे national movement में, जो कि BJP थकती नहीं है बताते हुए, वो तो अगर उनकी history आप सुनो तो ये लगेगा कि हमारे national movement leaders तो एक दूसरे से लड़ते ही रहते थे। पता नहीं नेशनल मूवमेंट हो कैसे गया, गांधी भगत सिंह से लड़ रहे हैं, नेहरू गांधी जी से लड़ रहे हैं, सुभाष बोस गांधी जी से लड़ रहे हैं, एटसेट्रा एटसेट्रा, बट दैट वाज नॉट इट। डिस्पाइट देयर डिफरेंसेस दे वर एबल टू यूनाइट एंड दे वर एबल टू वर्क टुगेदर। दिस इज द लेसन दैट वी हैव नॉट लर्नड। वी आर नॉट एबल टू, वी आर स्टिल डूइंग पेटी पॉलिटिक्स कि मैं चीफ मिनिस्टर बनूंगा या तू चीफ मिनिस्टर बनेगा, कि मेरे इससे के जो लोग हैं, माई फैक्शन पीपल विल गेट मोर सीट्स और योर फैक्शन विल गेट, वेयर इज द ब्रॉड विजन इन विद विच विद ओनली विद विच कैन यू फाइट दिस विजन। बट लेट अस एक्सेप्ट इट दैट द कम्युनलिस्ट्स हैव प्लेस्ड अ विजन इन फ्रंट ऑफ आवर पीपल, अ कम्युनल विजन, अ हॉरिबल विजन, अ डिस्ट्रक्टिव विजन, बट इट इज अ विजन। वी कैनॉट फाइट दैट विजन विद पेटी पॉलिटिक्स। It has to be with another alternate vision and much bigger vision. And a bigger vision requires big politics. It requires politics of unity. It requires politics of giving into the other, of often of enormous generosity towards each other, which is exactly what the national movement had. Subhash Bose, when he leaves the Congress party, forms another party, even then when a meeting is held, the Congress calls Subhash Bose to come and discuss. At independence, Ambedkar, who had nothing to do with the Congress party, is invited to not only head the writing of the constitution, but as a minister in the government, you know, there was an attempt to build a nation, build it together, you know, remove your differences, deal with those differences creatively, learn from each other and grow, which Nehru did from Gandhi and vice versa. Both of them grew. Nehru's autobiography is a critique of Mahatma Gandhi. And yet they were able to work together. Now, why are we not? Why are all the left parties not united? I mean, it would be a simple question to ask. Everybody in the name of Marxism. And why are even the left parties not united on this battle? Why do we still have alternate visions, alternate this, that, and the other, mostly factional, not even ideological differences? So I think, as you have correctly said, that if we read our history, and that is why the intelligentsia is necessary, that we should not have to wait for another Second World War situation. We do not have to wait till our people and our history and our society, our civilization is decimated to recreate it all over again. Waiting for that is lunacy. Why should we wait for that occasion and not fight for it while there is still time?
Professor Karen Gabriel is there back. Can I? Please.
Sorry, I just had some difficulty asking myself. I could hear you at that time. But it's always such a pleasure to listen to Professor Mukherjee. And I just actually have some sharing, you know, some concerns I have. Not to beg what he says. But I'm just wondering, you know, on the question of what are the possibilities going forward. So in the situation, as I see, there is, you know, the destruction of the institutions or loss of their credibility. For instance, and that was in ways media, as Sadhna said, is gone. So we are then, unless you're looking at, you know, the alternative media, which is then working through, sometimes through social media and so on, but mainstream media is gone. So that one pillar gone. The judiciary seems to be its way out, and there is kind of an open culture now of psychophancy that has come. I know it has been there in previous times as well, but I think this has now become more complicated.
Please. You're done, ma'am? No, please. You'd like to add, sir? What she said?
Unfortunately, Karen, your comment, a lot of it did not come through because of connectivity. But I get the general drift of what you are saying, and I'm in agreement with what you are. Again, as I said, but I'm not despondent. I will repeat and say that the situation in each one of these items, the judiciary, the media, the bureaucracy, was much worse in the colonial period. And yet, the people found ways of reaching out to the people. You did not need newspapers and you did not need social media to reach people even during the mutiny. You know, people had in the middle of the 19th century, if you have something to say and something meaningful to say to people, there will be ways of reaching out. I am quite convinced. And that is certainly what our history shows, that much worse domination, much more control of the state, much worse tightening up of the... You were sent to Andaman for writing article. Tilak was sent away to Burma for defying the censorship act on the press. And yet the nationalists were able to fill the minds of the Indian people. So and why should we say that there is no way out? That the genius of the Indian people, if we have faith in our people, if we interact with them, I'm sure there will be ways to reach out.
There is a question from Kavita Srivastava. Granted, the RSS was given political space by JP, which needs to be talked about. However, how do we understand their spread now, where the majority's mindset is convinced by their ideology? The majority Hindus are convinced about the RSS brand of Hindutva, which they think is raising their prestige as Hindus. She adds, only movements can fight back, but the tragedy is that movements are still mostly issue-based. Where is the question of democracy at democratic rights is at the core, where farmers' movements for MSP or Dalit movements' movement for justice for the Hathras movements, where are those questions today? That is our question, Kavita Srivastava.
Very, very, very profound and good question. I'm in total agreement with you. But there are these movements. What is lacking is the political parties taking up these movements. In fact, almost all the urges that you're seeing, the positive urges in the area of environment, in the area of the rights to education, to employment, for the poor, are occurring in the area among civil society movements. But where are the political parties taking them up as critical frontal issues? That is one major thing. But secondly, I don't want to, I hope it is not being taken like that. I'm not focusing only on JP. I gave a whole list of reasons why we've reached this current denouement of the domination of the communal viewpoint. And in one of those factors was this playing politics in association with the communal forces to overthrow another secular party. And JP's movement was one such example. 1989 was an equally good example of that. There was no JP at that time. There was no emergency happening in 1989. Rajiv Gandhi was not Indira Gandhi. Now, why did the entire spectrum, including the left, have to join hands with BJP to overthrow the party? So it is a tendency. JP movement represented that tendency. But this tendency, as Kumar Ketkarji said, started much earlier. The Congress right wing was willing to have strange bedfellows in among the communalists, even before, in the late 60s itself. So surely this is one of the evils. But the most important, I had said earlier, was the absence of an ideological battle, of making it a central issue by any political formation, that this is the central issue in today facing our democracy, that this positing of communalism versus democracy has not occurred in a sufficient manner, and it needs to be if we are to combat.
Kavita wants to add a few words. Kavita?
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah, please. Yes.
Because, there was a problem, so I could not even hear. I'm so happy to be part of this meeting and would love to hear you even more, Professor Mukherjee, and would love Subhash to be moderating many more such seminars. What I want to say, I am somebody who believes in action. And I think the last part of your lecture, what to do. I think at the end of the day, if you have to save even myself, from going into prison, I have little time. Because we know how dissenters and intellectuals, that's part of the tools of fascism, or whatever you call it, the tools of Hindutva, finishing all voices. So we're all in the queue. And I'm not like trying to put it as a badge on myself, but for me, there's little time. I cannot be sitting across tables. I really want to be with people. So I want to share a couple of things. And I also agree with you about the political parties. And that's the biggest strategy. We've had Bhima. I want to talk about Bhima Koregaon and Delhi riots. I remember that when Tada came, Justice Tharkunde, Rajinder Satchar, everybody worked hard, and later Kanabiran for Pota, to get an all-party formation, to have an alliance across parties. I'm talking a very small part of all that you've said. I'm talking of something that prevents you from being criminalized, that prevents all of us sitting in this room from being slapped with UAPA, which we can. Now, we are waiting. We, as PUCL, worked very hard. And exactly a month ago, on the 21st of October, we did this massive meeting with one chief minister and seven representatives of political parties. And we had some civil society people also. And then we are urging, there was Bihar elections, but Bihar and other elections will keep happening. We have to work to prevent any further arrests that are going to take place, whether even something like Hathras. My disappointment was, I'm part of the whole anti-rape movement and what Hathras represented for Dalit women. I mean, that kind of intersectionality, we spoke about it first. But we never spoke enough about the UAPA cases slapped on four people. I mean, even if one or two or three of them were PFI, why? How can you slap these cases? 21 cases on Chandrasekhar Azad's people. So not enough was said. I mean, of course, the narrative was, definitely went much deeper. My point is that on the one hand, we know that the judiciary is going to be very selective. I don't have to go into it. It's like almost farcical what's happening. Yet, whatever there is, how does this kind of an assembly get the political parties? I mean, I want to ask you people. All of us are in touch with political parties. Kumar Ketkar is here. Congress is the slowest. I mean, he may be he may have come through Congress. We know he's much larger than anything to do with Congress. Congress is slowest in any of this. They don't want to talk about ITCA. They don't want to talk about Bhima Koregaon. They don't want to, one or two individuals in the party. How? I'm just saying that let's get down. Father, stand. Varavara Rao, two octogenarians. Till when will we watch this? I'm sorry, I'm reducing this great lecture of this, but I'm saying our discourse has to, at the end of the day, as you said, restore democracy. I mean, our movements, at the end of the day, have to be civil liberties movements at this point of time. They have to restore democracy. They have to restore civil liberties of those which has been snatched. Varavara Rao, his health is declining. What are we doing? I don't want to go individually, but that's part of the larger symptom. Symptom that you talked about, and I'm putting it specifically through some illustrations. And for me, individual civil liberties also matters. And I don't know how to move these parties. And our PUCL is trying out. We don't know. We are collectively with others. We are trying out. Sorry. I really wanted to share this.
Thank you so much, Kavita, for this very moving and very appropriate intervention. I could not agree with you more. It's people like you, I think, who are going to be the future. The only tragedy, as you have correctly said, is it's not that the knowledge is not there or there are not enough people to fight like you and so many others. It's that the political process refuses to pick it up. That a Kashmir can happen. That you can put an entire state in jail. And the secular parties are not even united on that. Tomorrow it will be Bengal. Day after it will be somebody else. The fact that we do not see that it is not only just Stan Swamy and Varavara Rao, that is barbaric. That is not only just oppressive, it is just barbaric. But the fact that we do not see that the next in line is you yourself, as you correctly said, is what is shocking. The political process should not respond to this, especially in a country like ours with a rich history of our political past. It is quite shocking. I totally agree with you. But then, as I said, the positive side, we are permanently optimistic. The positive side that there are people like you.
Anil Kumar Singh wants to raise it. He has raised his hand. Anil ji.
Namaskar. बहुत ही थॉट प्रोवोकिंग भाषण रहा आज मुखर्जी सर का. हम लोग दूरदराज में बैठे हैं तो बहुत खुशी हो रही है सुन के. बहुत सारी बातें उन्होंने की और हम लोग तो इन्हीं लोगों को पढ़ के और इनकी बातें सुन के ही उसको ट्रांसलेट करने की कोशिश करते हैं लोगों के बीच में. मैं जो बातें कहना चाहता था उसका बड़ा हिस्सा तो कविता श्रीवास्तव जी ने अभी बोला कि जो बौद्धिक वर्ग है अभी हम लोगों ने बहुत ही थॉट प्रोकिंग भाषण सुना. लेकिन अभी जिस तरह की स्थितियां हैं, अभी एक बड़ा मजाकिया एक अभी हुआ मेरे साथ कि मैं सड़क पे जा रहा था और मैं इस भाषण को सुन रहा था और एक मंदिर यहाँ है अयोध्या में, उसके प्रबंधक है, वो मिल गए सड़क पे. तो तो उन्होंने कहा कि आप किससे फोन पे बात कर रहे हैं रास्ते में जाते हुए, तो मैंने कहा कि मैं प्रोफेसर आदित्य मुखर्जी जी का भाषण सुन रहा हूँ। फिर मैंने मोबाइल उनके कान पे लगाया जिससे उनको भरोसा हो जाए कि मैं बात नहीं कर रहा हूँ। तो उन्होंने कहा कि उसके बदले में उन्होंने कहा कि कुछ अंग्रेजी में उन्होंने सुना उसमें बोलते हुए उनको, तो कहा कि बिहार हम लोगों ने जीत लिया, अभी बंगाल भी हम जीतने जा रहे हैं। तो पढ़ाई लिखाई के प्रति या जो रेडिकल विचार है, इस तरह के जो विचार है प्रगतिशील, उनके प्रति जो जिस तरह का बौद्धिक पहुंच आरएसएस की है, क्योंकि उनके यहाँ तो बाकायदा बौद्धिक प्रकोष्ठ भी है, बौद्धिक होता है उनके यहाँ, बाकायदा बौद्धिक होता है। हमारे साथ दिक्कत यह है कि हम, मुझे लगता है, मैं बहुत विनम्रता से प्रोफेसर मुखर्जी साहब से भी पूछना चाहूंगा कि हमारे यहाँ बात पहुंच नहीं पाती है मॉसेस तक। हम सारी बात आपकी जो सुने हैं, बहुत ही वो चीजें हम लोगों ने देखा भी अपनी आंख से, और बहुत ही वो वैचारिक रूप से समृद्ध करती है और एक दृष्टि देती है इस समय जबकि चारों तरफ से हम घिरे हुए हैं, लेकिन वह बातें मॉसेस तक कैसे पहुंचे एक बड़ी समस्या है, क्योंकि उनका जो बौद्धिक होता है संघ का वो तो पहुंच जाता है, हमारे जो बुद्धिजीवी हैं वो कब जन बुद्धिजीवी में बदलेंगे या कब उनकी बात हम पहुंचा पाएंगे। मुझे लगता है एक तो भाषा की भी बहुत समस्या है, अभी फ्रीडम मूवमेंट की बात हो रही थी और वो जो पूरा मास मूवमेंट के रूप में गांधी जी ने या कांग्रेस ने उस समय खड़ा किया था, तो उसकी भाषा आप देखिए कि देश की कई भाषाओं का देश है ये, लेकिन उसकी मुख्य भाषा हिंदी जैसी हो गई थी और हिंदी में ही ज्यादातर राष्ट्रवादी नेता बोलते थे। तो अंग्रेजी सबको नहीं आ सकती है, जरूरी नहीं कि सबको हिंदी आए, लेकिन कुछ तो रास्ता निकालना होगा, क्योंकि जिस तरह की मूर्खता, जिस तरह का एक इलिटरेसी, पॉलिटिकल सोशल इलिटरेसी और जाहिलपन जिसे कहा जाता है, इस बौद्धिक ने आरएसएस के भरा है लोगों के दिमाग में, जब वो पढ़ने लिखने के लिए तैयार हैं और किसी को भी अगर उन्होंने कुछ सीधी हिंदी बोलते सुन लिया तब भी कहेंगे कि मोदी जी जिंदाबाद, तो उनको पढ़ाई लिखाई तक से चिढ़ हो गई है। हम लोग जिस जगह है वो तो बहुत ही भयानक जगह है। तो ये मैं यही सब जानना चाहता हूँ कि ये बातें जो हम लोग करते हैं, जो हमारे प्रोफेसर करते हैं, जो हमारे इंटेलेक्चुअल्स करते हैं, ये बातें कैसे पहुंचेंगी, अगर हम अपनी सामाजिक भूमिका को कैसे देखेंगे लोगों में, क्योंकि हम जनता को कन्विंस नहीं कर पा रहे हैं, लोगों को कन्विंस नहीं कर पा रहे, क्योंकि वो सही बात भी उनको हम नहीं पहुंचा पा रहे हैं। मुझे लगता है एक भारी समस्या ये है, और मुझे अभी भी आशा है कि अगर सही बात लोगों तक पहुंची, मॉसेस तक पहुंची, तो अभी भी इनका तंबू खड़ा जा सकता है, मुझे ऐसा लगता है पर्सनली। बहुत धन्यवाद आपने मुझे मौका दिया, शुक्रिया।
डॉक्टर सिंह, मैं आपसे अग्री कर सकता हूँ, बिल्कुल ठीक कह रहे हैं, ये बहुत बड़ा चैलेंज है कि हम अपनी बात आम जनता तक कैसे पहुँचाएं। मैंने ये लेक्चर जरूर अंग्रेजी में दिया, इसका मतलब ये नहीं कि मैं हिंदी में नहीं लेक्चर देता हूँ। हम कोशिश करते हैं, हिंदी मेरे को नहीं आती, मेरी मातृभाषा नहीं है, हम कोशिश करते हैं जिस भी भाषा में बोल सके, परंतु मेरे ख्याल से जो हार्ट ऑफ द मैटर है वो लैंग्वेज नहीं है। नेशनल मूवमेंट के टाइम पे ज्यादा से ज्यादा बड़े बड़े जो लीडर थे, दादाभाई नौरोजी जी को गुजराती के सिवा और अंग्रेजी के सिवा कोई लैंग्वेज नहीं आती थी, इट डिडंट मैटर। वो जिस भाषा में भी लिखते थे, अंग्रेजी न्यूज़पेपर्स अगर उस वक्त सबसे ज्यादा पॉपुलर थे, उसका नेक्स्ट डे सारे वर्नैक्युलर्स में आग की तरह बात फैल जाती थी, देयर वाज अ लिंक ऑल ओवर द कंट्री। अब वो सारा टूट चुका है वर्नैक्युलर में, जो आप कह रहे हो ना हिंदी में और लोकल लैंग्वेजेस में, तो ज्यादातर तो आपको मालूम ही है कि कौन सी दृष्टिकोण फैलाई जाती है। ये नहीं है कि लोकल भाषाओं में बहुत रेडिकल दृष्टिकोण फैल रही है, लोकल भाषाओं में उल्टा हो रहा है। ये लिंक जो मीडिया में भी था बिटवीन द मेन स्ट्रीम न्यूज पेपर्स और वर्नैक्युलर न्यूज पेपर, वो टूट चुका है। तो ये आपकी बात बिल्कुल सही है कि मासेस तक कैसे पहुंचाने। आपने कहा, कविता जी ने कहा, जो भी कंसर्न्ड है इस सिचुएशन में, ये तो सबसे पहला प्रश्न रहेगा ही। पर हम कहते हैं जो गांधी जी की जो एक बड़ी पॉपुलर बड़ी इम्पोर्टेंट बात है कि वी कैनॉट वेट फॉर द रेवोल्यूशनरी मोमेंट, कि कब सब कुछ बदल जाएगा। जितना कर सकते हैं वो तो करें। ही सेज, इफ आई एम विलिंग टू अलाय विद एनीबॉडी हु कम्स वन स्टेप फॉरवर्ड, आई डोंट वेट कि वो 90 स्टेप मेरी तरफ आएगा तभी मैं उसको अपना एलाई बनूंगा। हमारे यहाँ तो यही है, हम तो जो हमारे साथ 50% अग्रीड है उसको भी साथ में लेने को नहीं तैयार है, कहते या तो तुम बिल्कुल ही मेरे साथ आ जाने, तो मैं तुम मेरे साथ नहीं है। तो वो गलत है। if all of us were to do our little bit in our families, in our schools, in our colleges, फर्क ऐसे ही आता है. पर इंसान ये कहता है जी अब क्या कर सकते हैं, मीडिया तो बड़ी पावरफुल है, ये बड़ा पावरफुल है, ये वो, हम सब कुछ ना कुछ कर सकते हैं. पर आर वी डूइंग दैट? हमने हिंदुस्तान में करीब 3000 घंटे की इंटरव्यूज करी सारे देश में. हमने शुरू किया केरल से शुरू किया, कैसरगोड नॉर्दर्न मोस्ट डिस्ट्रिक्ट ऑफ केरला, और डिस्ट्रिक्ट बाय डिस्ट्रिक्ट हम सारे हिंदुस्तान घूमे टू टॉक टू द ऑर्डिनरी पीपल, द मासेस ऑफ द पीपल हु पार्टिसिपेटेड इन द नेशनल मूवमेंट. लीडरों से बात करने नहीं गए थे हम, विलेज लेवल पे जो दलित औरत है, जो ऑर्डिनरी वर्किंग वर्कर है, उससे पूछने गए थे कि भाई आप कैसे वर्किंग क्लास मूवमेंट में जुड़े, आप कैसे कम्युनिस्ट मूवमेंट में जुड़े. तेलंगाना गए हम, गुजरात गए, बारदोली गए, हर जगह गए जहां पे मूवमेंट्स हुई ये पता करने. तो वहां पे हमें अजीब सी बात पता लगी, 90% ऑफ द पीपल जिनको हमने इंटरव्यू किया उनको पूछा कि भाई आप पॉलिटिक्स में कैसे आए, कहता जी हमारे स्कूल मास्टर ने हमको कहा कि बेटा देश के लिए कुछ करो, और हमारी माँ ने हमको कहा. बाप की बात नहीं करते थे लोग, कहते थे हमारी माँ ने कहा कि कुछ करो. यू नो, सो देयर इज अ रोल दैट एवरीबॉडी कैन प्ले. A school teacher can play, a mother at home can play, a child at home can play quarreling with their parents for their obscurantist or negative views, etc., etc. हम उसको इस्तेमाल नहीं करते हैं, on the one hand. On the other, जो बड़ी मोटी बात है कि जब तक ना the main political process joins this, तब तक victory बहुत बहुत दूर है. Impossible नहीं है, पर बहुत दूर है. ये तो मैं तो कविता और सबसे टोटली एग्री करता हूँ कि वी हैव टू इन्फ्लुएंस द पॉलिटिकल प्रोसेस. सबको दुश्मन बना के सिर्फ गाली दे के नहीं चलेगा. अगर हम, मैंने आज कांग्रेस की और लेफ्ट की क्रिटिक करी है तो इसलिए नहीं कि भाई हम इनके बाहर कुछ रास्ता निकालेंगे, इन्हीं के थ्रू हमको रास्ता निकालना है. नहीं तो और कोई हमारे पास बाहर से कोई नहीं आएगा पार्टी हमको सेव करने के लिए. इट हैज टू बी फ्रॉम विद इन आवर पॉलिटिकल फोर्सेस हु हैव मेनी क्वालिटीज. The whole the revolutionary tradition of the left is with you. The whole revolutionary tradition of the Congress party is with you. हम उसके साथ कैसे लिंक करें?
I think with this note, we should conclude this meeting, because the way the manner in which you analyze the challenge of fascism and the need to come together is really important. And I think it's for all of us on the left to understand their limitations, their compromises, their at times their inability to understand the danger of fascism and aligning with fanatic forces also at times. So I think I once again thank Prasad Aditya Mukherjee. I would like to make one short announcement also. The next lecture in this series, Kumar Ketkarji has agreed to deliver this lecture. So I will share the details with you in a few days. And you please subscribe to our New Socialist Initiative Facebook page to get updates. Once again, I thank Professor Aditya Mukherjee and all of you for joining this debate. Thanks.